Now, as you can see, I've not stopped my comments. Scott is not feeling well, so I got word last night that he would not be able to be here this morning. So I'm your guest preacher. In the readings that we have today, which you will hear the same reading, especially the Transfiguration, on the Feast of the Transfiguration, which is in August. But it's placed here at, on the last Sunday of Epiphany, right before we have Lent. And I think it's really appropriate that it falls at this particular time. In our reading from Exodus, Moses is seen as an ideal for us. The way he interacts with God. God spoke to him. He was obedient. He heard what God had to say. He was obedient. He ascended into the mountain. And in another place, it says the people said, "You go ahead." And it wouldn't, probably. You know, here's this mountain that has clouds and maybe thunder. And it may have been a volcano. We don't know. But Moses went up there, not knowing what he would encounter. And he entered into a cloud of unknowing. In the late 14th century, there was a mystic who had written about the cloud of unknowing. That's what it's called. And it was really a guide to contemplation, contemplative prayer. And I think it's a wonderful term, the cloud of unknowing, because Moses did not know when he went up there. So he heard God's voice, he obeyed, and then he saw. And we can use the word "he saw" in a way that we've done when we say, "Now I see it." You know that knowing that we can have. And so Moses was the one who brought the law down to the people. It was a way in which they would live a moral life. But in the scripture that we have today, and following the scripture that we have today in Exodus, then they started talking about worship. And so in a way, it was a transition. The giving of the law taught them how to live. But then they were to worship God. So they were to enter into this cloud of unknowing also. They did not know where it would lead. And because it's a fearsome thing to enter into the cloud of unknowing, it's awesome for us too. And it could be fear-inspiring. But that's precisely what God is calling us to do. We had two psalm choices today. I didn't know which one we were going to be using, and I focused on the other one. But it was a psalm of ascent. And the people, when they would go into worship, they would sing songs as they went to the temple to worship. And it was about ascending higher and higher. And it has to do with God, just like the Psalm 99 does, has to do with God as king. In the first psalm, it talks about you, other kings of other nations, God holds you in derision. It's God who is king. He's the one that sits on the throne, really. He has an anointed person that he's placed on the throne, but he's the true king. When Jesus went up to the mountain, as he often did go up to a mountain, he went up there to pray. So when he took his closest disciples, Peter, James, and John, with him, it reminds us of the story when Jesus took Peter, James, and John in, and a small girl had died. And Jesus was asked to come, and he took that inner circle with him. And he told that little girl, "Rise up." And then she was given something to eat. So we have that nucleus, those people, Peter, James, and John, who were to be the leaders. Jesus took them up to the mountain too. So it would, as we read it, it reminds us of Moses going up the mountain. So when they get up there, then a cloud descends. Jesus is transfigured. Now the word transfigured in a dictionary says changed. That doesn't get it for me. I don't know about you all. But the actual word comes from metamorphosis. Transfigured is from metamorphosis. And you all remember from biology hearing about butterflies, caterpillars? And what a wonderful picture, because it's as if they die. They go in, you know, go into this cocoon. They're there for a while. And when they emerge, it's a whole different thing. It's a beautiful butterfly. So that was the word that was used, that Jesus was transfigured. The disciples had been following Jesus for a long time, going from town to town, spending lots of time with him, eating with him. They knew him as Jesus the man. But now they were seeing the glory of Jesus in his fullness of glory. In our clergy Bible study on Monday, we got into a usual conversation. Was this a post-resurrection story that happened to be placed in this place? I don't know. What I do know is it could have fit very well at this time in their journey to go up to the mountain, to ascend up that mountain, to see this Jesus with whom they have been sharing their lives for the last few years, and see him transformed, transfigured, metamorphosized, I guess, I don't even know if that's a word, right before them. In the prophecy of Daniel, in the book of Daniel, the 7th chapter, there is spoken of one who was with the Ancient of Days, and he was like the Son of Man. The description is very similar to what we have with Jesus. Talked about his light, his hair was like white wool. You might go back and read it. Jesus often called himself the Son of Man. So Jesus, once again, is fulfilling prophecy. So we have up on the mountain, we have the great lawgiver, if you will, Moses. And then we have Elijah, the great prophet. So they hear this voice. They see Jesus transfigured. They hear this voice. This is my beloved Son, with whom I'm well pleased. It might remind us of Jesus' baptism. Then one, the Holy Spirit came like a dove, and there was a voice. In one account, it says, this is my Son. In another account, it's speaking to Jesus, you are my Son. So it reminds us of the baptism. This was a time in which they were getting ready to go to Jerusalem. It was right before they came off the mountain to head toward Jerusalem. I've often wondered if Jesus didn't need that experience for himself, for what he was going to face. He told the disciples, don't share this with anyone until after I'm risen. They wouldn't have really understood at that point what all this meant. In Jewish law, you had to have two witnesses if you were bringing a claim against someone. We saw that in the trial of Jesus. For two people, they found two people to say the same thing. Jesus took three people up that mountain, his inner circle. And they were headed toward Jerusalem. I can only imagine if we were on top of that mountain by ourselves and saw that, we'd probably come off the mountain going, did I really see that? So perhaps part of it was for their reassurance and retreat. They saw the same thing. But it wouldn't make sense until after Jesus' death, his burial, and his resurrection, and they saw Jesus again. It wouldn't make sense. When Peter is trying to communicate his experience, it was difficult. You know how it is. You've had some very important things that you have experienced, heartfelt things, and you try to explain it to another person. And it's just like, it's like this, or it was like that, or you try your best to communicate the depth of it to another person. Many of us remember September 11th, and we can remember where we were, what we saw, what we heard, our own sense of anxiety. I certainly do. Some of us remember when JFK was murdered. We remember that. Some of you were here when I talked about the adoption of my daughter, trying to communicate the joy that I experienced, or the birth of my son. Things of the Spirit, when we want to communicate how God has touched us, sometimes leaves us a bit baffled. And so we do it by telling stories, painting word pictures. Some of us don't share it at all, and yet we're called to do that. Our presiding bishop will be in town in April, and he's going to talk about sharing the good news. And if any of you have ever heard him, you know you're in for a treat. He's an awesome preacher. So we're called to ascend mountain too. Enter into mystery. Some of us are very literal. We want to see, we touch, feel, have it solid. And yet we're called to enter in with faith. Enter into that cloud of unknowing. Moses ascended that mountain, but it was a progressive thing. If we talk about the mountain, spiritually speaking, he learned more and more and more. But he heard, he obeyed, and then he saw. And that's what we're called to do too. We're to hear what Jesus has to say to us, then obey to the best of our ability. And in doing that, we come to see. We come to experience. Some of us have not gotten there yet, but the Holy Spirit can lead you into that place. But we need to put aside our preconceptions, how it ought to be. The disciples had to do that. Jesus was not what they imagined from prophecy. And we are invited into that cloud of unknowing, to open ourselves up to whatever it is that God wants to show us in the person of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.